It's time for the next presenter, and that is going to be Franz. And I looked at his bio, and it says, "Grumpy infrastructure engineer, Nixos security team, and retired release manager." I basically know him as a very friendly person, and he's here to talk about redesigning Nixos networking. So give him a warm round of applause, and let's enjoy his talk.
So hi, I hope you had a nice lunch. Let's dive right in. I'm a system engineer at Mayflower. I'm using NixOS since 2014. And yeah, security team and release manager, you heard about that already. So NixOS networking. We have two main networking implementations in NixOS. That's on the one hand scripted networking, which is a set of bash scripts wrapped around systemd units. That's our default implementation. And we have networkd, that's part of systemd. We have network manager, which is mostly geared to desktop use. So I'm leaving that out here. The challenges we face with that is that the scripted networking is very fragile, especially for complex setups. We have a confusion around the networking targets. We have DHCP activated on all interfaces by default. We have some modern Linux networking features like new interface types and stuff that we just don't support natively in our networking configuration. There are hacks around that. But there are also ways to make it nicer. So, about scripted networking. These are a bunch of systemd units, which basically call IP route. The problem here is we have dependencies to like bring up bridges with slave interfaces that also depend on device units in systemd, but unfortunately this doesn't work quite well. Especially in dynamic setups, things tend to break, or if you have complex setups like you have a bonding interface, and on top you have VLAN interfaces and even more interfaces stacked on top of each other, things tend to break in very weird ways. So the idempotency is not always guaranteed. The reason for that is, among other things, that in most cases when we have layered interfaces, they are deleted instead of reconfigured. So as an applications break because of that, some routes or default routes get lost, and you can end up with a system if you do a Nixos rebuild and change some aspects of your network configuration, it might lose connectivity to the network. And if it's a VM or a server somewhere, you're in a world of pain. So we don't want that. There have been many fixes in the last few years in the networking, scripted networking configuration, but it never worked out so it will work for any use case. On the other hand, we have a networkd-based networking backend. That's in NixOS since the end of 2014. And what you can do is you can just set networking.useSystemd to true, and you can use your existing networking configuration, like your interface IP configuration and default gateway, and it will just use networkd and generate the networkd configuration files. Unfortunately, some of the features we currently have in networking are not implemented, for example, static routes, so you might run into trouble there. And the cool thing is, networkd has like a declarative configuration, just like systemd itself has with its unit files. And it works much better in dynamic environments. So I'm advocating here that we should move to networkd. Why should we move to networkd? NixOS already uses systemd, and we're already shipping networkd by default in our systemd closure. So it's already installed on all of your NixOS systems. Also, with our scripted networking, we decided to re-implement the wheel and do our own network management stack. And implementing a network management stack is pretty hard because there are a lot of edge cases and some moving parts around the whole ecosystem of networking. What's also cool is that NetworkD has a container integration into the systemd container machine facility, which we also like to have for our Nixos containers to make them even greater. There are also a few drawbacks. So when we implement NetworkD, we have an even tighter coupling of Nixos to systemd. I'm also not a big fan of systemd. It's a more of a love-hate relationship, to be honest. But it's the best thing we have. And yeah, we should just use NetworkD instead. Also, NetworkD is not perfect because it advertises that it's probably gonna work out, but idempotency is not guaranteed. So it has a very simplistic convergence approach that Andy told me like yesterday at the bar. I didn't know that before. So it's, in some ways it could break, but it's an improvement upon our current scripted networking setup. So about NetworkD. NetworkD also has unit files. There are three kinds of unit files: netdev, link, and network. So netdev is to create network interfaces, for example, bridges, bonding interfaces, TAN interfaces. Link is to configure network interfaces. So for example, to set the MTU or to set the MAC address of an interface. And network is to like do the IP configuration, IPv4, IPv6, enable DHCP, and the like. There's also a nice network CTL command where you can get the state of the NetworkD and your current network settings. Be aware you can't modify these settings. Everything has to be done in the unit files, and also NetworkD can be easily reloaded. You have to restart it. And that's also the reason why it can break, but in most cases it won't break. It also has a lot of cool features. For instance, the thing I'm gonna go into next, like you can define which interfaces are required for setting the online state. It has also fine-grained privacy options that you would normally set via SysFS or PROCFS, and also per interface. And it will set them when the interfaces come up. So before, if you want to set IPv6 privacy extensions via the boot sysctl setting, it could fail when the interface isn't there yet. This will work. Also, we don't have support for routing policy rules with IP rule. That's also in NetworkD per interface. There are other Linux networking features that are unsupported. One cool feature is VRFs, virtual routing and forwarding interfaces. We have to thank Andy Ramholt for that. He's also here. He implemented that into NetworkD. So the cool thing about VRFs is you can think of it as a kind of bridge. So it has slave interfaces that are then bound to a specific routing table defined in the VRF, and all traffic flows through that routing table. So you can replace policy routing with that approach. It's interesting because you don't have to set up IP rules for that. You just have a new interface and add slave interfaces just like a bridge. There are other stuff we are not supporting yet. Lots of tunneling protocols that are available, like layer 3 tunnels, layer 2 tunnels, and the new IPsec tunneling interface is not available. So if you know IPsec, it's a little bit difficult in the Linux kernel because it's like a whole other stack and you don't really see all the IP tables associations or routes that are available in IPsec. With these tunneling interfaces, you are still doing the key exchange in user space, but you have an interface for the IPsec traffic. It's a lot nicer because it can do firewalling and other stuff just like our normal interfaces, you're accustomed to. And which are already set, all those options that you would traditionally set via PROCFS or SysFS. So, as an example, and to get to know a bit of Network D, I want to show you my Road Warrior setup on this laptop. I have an always-on WireGuard VPN. Oh, by the way, Network D also supports WireGuard, and our own MIC92 implemented that into Network D. We have a lot of Network D contributors in our community. So I have a WireGuard VPN, and I have a VRF that contains all my uplink interfaces, so my wired interface and my wireless interface. And by that, I'm ensuring that there's no traffic leakage outside of the VPN. So in my main routing table, there are just the routes through the VPN. And in an extra routing table, in my case, routing table one, all the routes for the uplink interfaces are located. So every application just sees the routes and also the IPs, in my case, of the VPN interface. Okay, so let's dive in into the setup. I'm not showing any NixOS configuration here, just for you to get a feel of, like, this is the Network D unit files. The first one is my uplink netdev unit. That's the VRF interface. It's called uplink, and it's a VRF interface, and it is associated to the routing table number one. Okay, that was easy. The other one, I'm sorry, that should say not netdev, but network here. The other one is the network unit file. There's a match clause here. That means I can match for, like, the name of the interface, the type of the interface. I can also use wildcards here. I can check which kernel I'm running, just like the normal systemd units. In this case, I'm just matching for the name uplink. And then I'm setting a route to my VPN gateway via that interface. So if you're setting a route via the VRF interface, the traffic to that destination will be routed through the VRF, and in my case, routed through my uplink interfaces. The next network unit is the unit for my wireless interface. So in this case, the name of wireless interface is WVLP2S0. This interface is not required for the online state because I just don't care if the wireless is up when I'm, like, booting the machine. And then I say, well, it's part of the VRF called uplink. I'm doing both DHCP v4 and DHCP v6. I also accept router advertisements. And this is a little hack I have to do because Network D relies on the kernel to accept router advertisements. So I have to tell him, the kernel, that he should put the routes into a routing table one. Then there are some settings for DHCP, because in my case, I like to be anonymous when I connect to random wireless networks. I set the anonymize flag to true. That's actually an RFC, so that systemd won't send my host name and won't send, like, a DUID in the DHCP requests and some other options. Furthermore, I set some more privacy options, like I don't use the upstream DNS or the upstream NTP. And there are much more options. For other systemd units, everything is documented in accompanying man pages. The next one is my WireGuard interface. So it's a netdev unit because I'm creating a new network interface. The type is WireGuard. I set some MTU on that, and that's the name WG-NU. I set my private key, my port, and one peer to my VPN gateway here. And allowed IPs to every IP because I want to route every traffic. Like, I want to add a default route for all traffic. As you can see here, I don't set any, or the next slide, I don't set any VRF because that will end up in my main routing table. This is in the network unit you see here. So I have a static network configuration. I have left out a legacy IP here because then the slide is a little bit shorter. But you can just use IPv4 addresses or IPv6 addresses accordingly. Okay. We can then take a look at let's make a little bit bigger. And here you can see, like, I have two wire interfaces in this case, which are still in the configuring state. Because, like, Network D already says here, no carrier because nothing is plugged in. My Wi-Fi interface is configured and routable, and also my WireGuard interface. You can also do, like, network CTL status. And it will print out a nice overview of the IP addresses you have configured and the gateways you have configured, and NTP servers and DNS servers. You can also do that by interface, like this, and get a short overview of the configuration and what configuration files they use. Okay. Let's get to another topic. A lot of contributors don't understand its network targets. So that's actually a convention by systemd. So the old LSB facility network has a lot of problems and misconceptions around it. So in different distributions, the network like script or a unit has different meanings, like is the network up, are the interfaces up, is like the network available as in routable, do you have real internet connectivity, or is just the network stack up? So systemd has defined it like this. So there is a network.target, which means that the networking stack is up. So like there's IP available, or like the networking itself. But the interfaces are not there don't have to be there, and they don't have to be configured. So if you depend on network target, you are in most cases doing it wrong. The only way you should depend on network target is with the after dependency. That means if the system is being shut down, the after ensures that the service where the after network target is defined will be shut down before the network is teared down. So the service can ensure that all connections have been terminated properly. That's the only use case for the network target in your dependencies. On the other hand, there's the network online target. That means that the interfaces have been configured and there are routable IPs configured on them. But even that should be used as a last resort because systemd mandates that services should support handling network reconfiguration gracefully. That means interfaces being removed, IPs being removed, routes being removed. Services are supposed to listen to RF netlink sockets and reconfigure themselves properly. So if the service doesn't support that, you should add a dependency with after and once to network online target. We have a few of those services. For example, the CloudInit service, because CloudInit requires network connectivity. That's a valid use case where you would depend on network online target. To know more, there's a nice site on the systemd wiki where everything about that is explained. So, what are my recommendations to change our networking setup? I also started with a lot of those easy recommendations. So there's a pull request incoming in the next 1 or 2 weeks. I propose to deprecate the scripted networking and remove it in one or two releases and make NetworkD our default network implementation. Also, of course, before that, we have to ensure that scripted and NetworkD has the same support the same features. And of course, we have to like implement a lot of new features that are available in NetworkD. The other thing is we have to check our service modules that the proper network targets are used. And the hard stuff and the breaking stuff, we have some options that are global, but which should be per interface. Because like, if I have a default gateway which isn't bound to any interface, how can that default gateway be set up? If you don't have the interface available, and in our case, there are cases when this happens and the network setup service will fail because there is no interface and the IP route add command will fail and then the networking will fail because the network setup service won't be restarted. Also other things like name servers and nothing should also be per interface. Because I don't want to have a name server in my resolve.conf when the interface isn't there. It just makes no sense to have the name server configured in that way. I also started implementing that already, but I'm not sure how we can deprecate those features gracefully. Also, another feature that we can't change gracefully is disable DHCP by default. So why disable DHCP by default? The problem is that NetworkD won't finish the like network online target when none of the interfaces are or some of the interfaces can't be configured because they are not there. Or in our case, we do DHCP on all interfaces, even on like VPN interfaces or like interfaces without a link. And in that case, they will still have like here the status configuring and won't be up yet. So, and to solve the bootstrap issue, I propose that Nixos generate configs, just generates a networking config that enables DHCP per interface that is available on the system at install time. I'm not sure how we ensure that we won't break existing setups, because most people won't have explicitly enabled networking.usedhcp. So that's a challenge, and I'm not sure if we can do that for the next release, but I hope we can make NetworkD the default anyway for the next release. So some related and future work that should be done on our networking stack. We should re-implement the Nixos container networking based on NetworkD. That would, for example, allow dynamic IP addressing, so you don't have to specify an IP for your Nixos containers if you don't need them, because they're available anyway via their name on the local system. Also, a firewall abstraction layer for services. So other firewall services have the concept of zones. We should adopt this and like cluster interfaces into firewall zones and make rules per zone. And of course, there are some more useful NetworkD features we should implement. And most of those, even custom options that are available in systemd, which you probably won't implement directly, should be moved to networking instead of systemd network, so to make them easier reachable. OK, that's it.
Wonderful. Thank you for your talk. And you even finished 6 minutes early, so we've got plenty of time for questions.
That was my intention.
Perfect. Here we go.
So this is more related to your Road Warrior setup. How do you handle captive portals temporarily to get your WireGuard tunnel up?
In that case, I'm just setting a route to that captive portal via the uplink interface. I have to do that manually, of course. And in case of name servers I have to use, I can also set them temporarily, because if you enable a network D, also resolve D is enabled, and you can use system D resolve and set a temporary name server if you need that, and then just remove that again. It's not ideal, but it works.
Okay, rather a proposal than a question. Would it be perhaps a good idea to host some network hacking sprint event, whatever, during perhaps January, February, somewhere, so some people can just get together for a day or two? I think that would drive especially such a complex case forward. So I would really be interested to attend.
Yeah, sure. As I said, I have already some work done, but it's much work in progress, and there are some cases where a little bit of discussion is needed. But as I said, like in next 1 or 2 weeks, I will put up a pull request, and you can look at that. Most of the changes just makes using NetworkD nicer in Ixos, and also implements a lot of new features. So yeah, but it's not done yet.
More questions? Oh.
So this is not something you touched on, but I guess it's something you might have an opinion on. Network device names in Ixos or in systemd. I kind of can remember my Ethernet device name, my wireless device name. I've got a wireless WAN card. That's like 25 digits long, that name. Is there a preferred way or a good way or just an acceptable way of renaming network devices?
That's possible. In the link unit, you can match via different... I'm not sure if it's per bus or something, at least per type and MAC address. And you can rename your interface in a link unit and then use that name in the network unit. So that's possible. And you can disable predictive interface naming, and you can use your own names.
Yeah, basically going to the same direction, I propose to not just match by interface name, but use those matching logics you just explained, about match about by MAC address or match by other aspects that systemd network already supports, to just use that for classification, not just a regular hostname. Also might cover some cases like people just want to configure, if I have a wired interface, just do DHCP on it, and not just I want to have this specific interface name to be configured. And side note to the Road Warrior setup, you set anonymized equals to true. This automatically implies not sending the hostname, so you can strip the other setting, splitting, removing the hostname from the DHCP request.
Not according to the man page, but okay. If you know that, okay. But I looked at the man page again, 2 hours ago.
There might be some inconsistency, but I looked into my and it says. But anyhow.
Yeah. Thanks.
More questions? No more questions, really. All right, there we go.
Is someone against it?
you propose to just remove some options from the default interface and move options to the interface themselves?
Yeah.
Would you see a way to keep a simple configuration for simple users? Like keep these options at the top level and basically apply them to all the interfaces, for example?
That would be possible, at least for the default gateway, because we could specify, it's also possible to specify an interface per default gateway. But I'd like to also unify our route setup in general. So the interface, some of the options can stay there, but for instance, the name servers can't stay there, unfortunately. But yeah, that's open to discussion, I guess. That's just my opinion.
Do you have a rough estimate when the old networking would be removed, or is that something that you would ever want to do?
Can I say again, what open working?
The old networking scripts, if you have a approximate timeline when they would be removed.
So I hope we can get it ready for the next release. Because we are adding a lot of new features, we should remove it 1 or 2 releases after, at the most, I guess. So that would be my ideal timeline for that.
Yes, hi. You mentioned network manager for desktop use. What would be your recommendation for desktop use then? Should the default be your proposal, or would network manager still be a good desktop option?
For desktop use, network manager is totally fine, in my opinion. So because you have probably seen that I'm very privacy aware, and network manager, like the current release, has most of the features you want. Like for example, MAC address randomization for like your interface and some other DHCP options I manually set. So if you take care of your network manager configuration, it's from a privacy aspect, it's totally fine. And also from an operational aspect. Also, of course, network D and network manager can be combined. Just don't configure your wireless interface via network D.
Alrighty, that's all the time they have. So thank you very much for your wonderful talk.